Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Exporting the Rapture, John Nelson Darby and the Victorian Conquest of North American Evangelicalism, by Donald H. Akenson. Narrated by Paul Boehmer. Introduction. This is the second volume in my tracing of the transatlantic journey of some of the central ideas of evangelicalism in the English-speaking world from their primary homeland, Ireland, surprisingly, to their primary present-day redoubt, the American Republic. This book is a standalone entity, and to make things convenient, I am summarizing here the more important points made in Discovering the End of Time, Irish Evangelicals in the Age of Daniel O'Connell, 2016. The scholarly listener probably should review the evidentiary and bibliographic conventions that are specified in that volume, as those protocols hold for the present one. However, there is nothing wrong with taking the present book as it stands. I hope it is obvious that for many of the individuals involved in my story, I have a clear affection. For others, I have respect. And for a few, both. Although I have no wish to write emollient history, many of the main characters are compelling, if not conventionally likable, or in many cases, normal. Few prophets are. One has a guarded admiration for some of the more imaginative leaders, most especially for John Nelson Darby, and especially for their creation of some wild masterpieces of religious thought. Ideational constructs that are the equivalent of Antoni Gaudi's Basilica and Expiatory Church of the Holy Family in Barcelona. My greatest historical affection, however, is for the second-line followers of the larger-than-life leaders, the men and women in the pews, the regular attenders at prayer meetings, and the sedulous note-takers at Bible studies, the kind of people who were my favorite aunts and uncles. To observe in several historical instances the interaction of big leaders and their ideas with everyday followers is gently confusing, not in an unsettling sort of way, but instead, bemusing. Bemusement is a kindly historical stance, and is what happens when one watches an event, or talks to someone, or reads a book and finds it quite interesting, a little puzzling, and withal just possibly a touch amusing. Bemusement, in this sense, is the instinctive posture of acceptance of things that are worth noting in themselves, but which one intuitively feels are also part of a pattern that one has yet to recognize. Here is an example. For 30 or 40 years, I have been bemused by a strange conjunction, one of which I was not so much a witness as a tiny bystander. When I was an infant, the aged pastor of the family church in Minneapolis First Baptist Church dandled me on his knee and gave me some kind of blessing, the sort acceptable to our family's Swedish Baptist heritage. From photos, it is clear that the aged gentleman was an imposing figure. He often dressed the way corporate lawyers had done in the 1920s, in striped trousers, morning coat, and a necktie that begged to be called a cravat. Among evangelicals, he was the Northern Magus. In the early 20th century, he had taken over the Swedish Baptist franchise in the States of the Old Northwest, and had done so in a campaign worthy of Clausewitz. From there, he moved on to bigger fights and bigger audiences. In his long career, he had been the chief figure in the World Christian Fundamentals Association, and, among other anti-modernist activities, was solidly behind the Scopes trial. He was not, by any stretch of the imagination, a nice man. But his frock-coated preaching and lawyerly dialectics framed the characteristic style of Northern evangelical dogmatics. No one could deny that his talons were long and his will strong. William Bell Riley. He retired as senior pastor of our church in mid-1946, and my uncle, Curtis B. Akenson, took over our church. However, Riley, always Dr. Riley to his followers, whether he was a serving pastor, was retired, or actually was no longer alive, remained the president of Northwestern College and Bible Schools, a set of institutions he had founded, and that, in influence, exceeded in upper Midwestern evangelical circles that of the famous Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. Dr. Riley looked for a successor, someone whose doctrinal beliefs were congruent with his own, but whose relative youth and vigor would energetically pass the faith to a new generation of soul winners. In mid-1947, the old man, in ill health, summoned a young Baptist preacher from the Mid-South and set himself in the role of the old prophet, Elijah. He was passing his mantle to young Elisha, 1 Kings, chapter 19, verse 19. The young clergyman overcame his deep reservations and became vice president of Northwestern College. He promised to take over as president for a time if Dr. Riley died, which inevitable transition was effected in December 1947, leaving William Franklin Graham, always Billy at the time, a long way from the ceremonial Dr. Graham, as the youngest college president in America, albeit of an unaccredited institution. Accreditation of the college was a side issue, for Graham was already established as a traveling evangelist. He was not around much and gave up the presidency in 1952. For administrative convenience, he moved the headquarters for his evangelical crusades to Minneapolis in early 1948, and most of the upper-level staff worshipped at First Baptist. That had not been a formal part of the deal with the late Dr. Riley, but these were people of good sense and of good manners, and they knew that whether or not obligations were put on paper, certain debts had to be paid. As children, we loved having the new people around. They were friendly and generous and so very different. There was a great joy in watching the oiled-haired Southern gents in two light suits. Did any real Minnesotan of that era ever wear a white linen suit? Their big-haired wives and their Orlon-sweatered daughters. They got on well with our parents. In the adult pre-church Bible study classes, they mixed easily with third and fourth generation Swedes who had been dutifully and industriously searching the scriptures for years and years, hoping that the rapture would occur quickly, or at least before next winter. Because of his crusading schedule, Billy Graham graced our pulpit rarely. The few times I was taken to a service to hear him give a brief message, the result was the same. Because we sat close to the raised rostrum, he loomed over us, an animated angel, and I got a terrible crick in the neck. That is not a bad thing, really. Looking up to a great man should do that. In their successive lives, William Bell Riley and Billy Graham delineated the spine of conservative evangelicalism in its American incarnation. Riley for the first half of the 20th century, Graham for the second. They were two very different human beings indeed, but at the time of their interchange, they were of one mind about the big doctrinal questions of the Christian faith. The question that has bemused me for so long is simply, where did this singularity come from? That query well might be a matter of inconsequential personal curiosity, except it turns out to be a metonymic. The Reverend Doctors Riley and Graham were a type of a larger phenomenon, the creation of one branch of American evangelicalism that, despite a cultural predisposition toward congregational atomization and frequent cults of personality, yield a remarkable set of agreed beliefs. there is a large and distinguished historical literature on American Protestantism, and, among other things, it illustrates clearly that any single phenomenon will have many possible webs of observation and explanation, and that no one narrative, model, or theory covers everything. In my reading, the closest anyone has come to chronicling the transatlantic intellectual cascade that produced the Christian belief system that W.B. Riley and Billy Graham embraced in their moment of unity was Ernest Sandeen in his Roots of Fundamentalism, British and American Millenarianism, 1800 to 1930, Chicago, University of Chicago Press, 1970. The book is something of a lost classic, in part because it became an artifact in a Methodenstreit about whether or not fundamentalist evangelicalism in the USA had a determinatively foreign ideological base. No surprise, Sandeen's view lost. His work was not disproved, but was disapproved of. The book became mostly a standard item in the formal bibliographies of Ph.D. theses and of monographs on 19th and 20th century American Protestantism, but seems to have been largely unassimilated. Granted, Sandeen's work has all sorts of weaknesses. It was primarily ideational history and had little room for social and organizational issues. But all books are imperfect, especially pioneering ones. Since Sandeen's time, a mass of manuscript and fugitive printed material has become available. Further, the social, economic, and, crucially, organizational context of the revolutionary ideas concerning God's ordering of human time that were invented, or some say rediscovered, in the early 19th century has become much clearer. The story is a dense one and needs both collective context and details about personalities if the development and transmission of the floridly seductive ideology that Riley and Graham shared, premillennial dispensationalism, to use its technical name, is to be comprehended. In Discovering the End of Time, Irish Evangelicals in the Age of Daniel O'Connell, I made a suggestion that is counterintuitive and yet is dictated by the historical record. Namely, that if one wants to find the inauguration point for the bundle of ideas that became the core of radical evangelicalism, then one has to look to a small patch of Southern Ireland after the end of the Napoleonic Wars. In a 20-year period in County Wicklow and South County Dublin, a thin but wealthy tranche of the Anglo-Irish landlord class, almost all of them adherents of the Church of Ireland, meaning Anglicans, mostly evangelicals, put together an innovative reading of the Scriptures, a new scheme of divine time, a model of extreme congregationalism, and an apocalyptic vision of the end of time. Whether or not each, all, or any of their constructs were brand new or were borrowed from their contemporaries is a question that gets lost in a black hole of evidentiary absence. What is certain is that the melding together of their ideas into a new system of apocalypticism was their own doing and was highly creative and unsettlingly innovative. As a group, the Irish evangelical radicals refused any formal designation, but they would usually accept brethren in everyday speech. Many foundational personalities, some of them big characters indeed, were part of the story, but the largest, by far, was John Nelson Darby. Chapter 1 will background his tortured, twisting, spiritually pyrotechnic life, and his hallucinogenic creativity up to the time of his leaving Ireland in 1837. There are informed scholars who would argue that if William Bell Riley and Billy Graham, at mid-20th century, embraced a set of core beliefs that were so close to being identical as to have been written by the same hand, The hand was that of Darby, a century earlier. The larger goal of this study is to go behind the largely covert history of the Darbyite branch of Brethrenism, usually called the Exclusive Brethren, and to show how the operative ideas came to be encased in a behavioral paradigm. Although Darby and his followers were consistent in stating their abhorrence of system, both of organizational and of theological systems, in reality, they developed a strong centralized ecclesiastical organization that intermeshed nicely with their complex doctrinal matrix. Their refusal to keep organizational records of even the most rudimentary sort, and their penchant for anonymity in their publications, in large part, explains why so much of Brethren history has indeed been covert history. My suggestion here is that during the years 1848 to 1882, the Darbyites perfected a form of group management that was an ideal vector for transmitting their ideas internationally and for injecting them into the North American evangelical realignment that followed the U.S. Civil War. Although sometimes ideas seem to flow across oceans purely by force of their own attractiveness, this was not the case with the apocalyptic dispensationalism of Darby and his followers. The transmission of the Exclusive Brethren's form of radical evangelicalism was dependent upon the this-world way the Darbyites set up their spiritual business. Erase the mundane from their history, and the heavenly disappears as well. Part 1. Setting out the stall. 1. Out of Ireland, John Nelson Darby, 1800 to 1837. In times of significant religious change, circumstances and revelation come together in personality. Some very big identities play a part in the story of transatlantic evangelicalism. Of these, some were expansive, showboat personalities, others managerial, others philanthropic, and still others were very compressed and intense individuals. None of the major shapers of modern evangelicalism was more focused, less willing to speak to the general public, less given to courting general approval, than was John Nelson Darby. Hence, it is not surprising that although at some time or another most evangelical pastors and lay leaders have heard the name of the Irish clergyman, they have promptly forgotten who he was. In any case, if they are aware of Darby, they do not want him as a forebear. Besides his intense absorption in his own theological interpretations, he also was as judgmental and excommunicative as a religious leader could be. Yet, at the same time, he and his followers frequently operated as stealth insurgents, sheep-stealing from other Protestant groups, especially those that were most sympathetic to evangelicalism and to biblical Christianity. Surprisingly, he was the chief, but not the only, framer of several of the constructs that underlay North American fundamentalism in the late 19th and the first half of the 20th centuries. His ideas, when taken together, can be seen as forming the fist within the evangelical glove. Neither this book nor its counterpart, Discovering the End of Time, Irish Evangelicals in the Age of Daniel O'Connell, 2016, is an attempt to write a biography of Darby, although one hopes that the material in each volume helps the eventual biographer of Darby. As I explained in the earlier volume, I do not believe that his life story can be successfully told at a level of detail and of documentation which it deserves until a generation or so from now. In large part, the problem is a technical one within the history trade. Darby published several million words in his lifetime, and most of his monographs, tracts, and fiats are not at present available in their original editions, but rather in a sequence of collected reprints that have gone through several editions without quality controls. And much the same problem holds for Darby's collected letters. On top of that, Darby and his followers were given to anonymous publishing or to coded indications of authorship, and they did not recognize the right of the civil state to require them to honor the requirement for legal deposit of their works. These and related matters are dealt with in the bibliographic essay at the end of my earlier study. An equally difficult problem stems from Darby's own secretive, costive, and compressed personality. Neither he nor most of the men and women who came under his influence were given to dwelling on the details of their own lives on this earth. In some degree, this was because of their coming to believe that they would soon be drawn into the heavens, so dealing with their own transient personal histories was a waste of time. Darby, however, went further than that. He was deeply secretive about his own personal life, and to a remarkable degree managed to scrub from his own writings and letters the most basic background material on his family and, surprisingly, even his own conversion. In his mature years, he wrote that he had loved Christ, I have no doubt sincerely and growingly, since June or July 1820 or 1821, I forget which. Without being at all arch, it is fair to note that there is no more personal information in the writings of John Nelson Darby than there is in the letters of St. Paul, and the epistles are blessedly shorter. From his own letters and writings, one would just barely reckon that Darby had a brother and a sister. Actually, he was the eighth of nine children and the youngest of six brothers. An apparently unmentionable father and a mother who was an icon to him, but whom he described in such a way as to lead early devotional biographers to infer that she had died when he was a child, though she lived comfortably on the family's Sussex estate well into her son's middle age. Darby's refusal to divulge details about himself was not born of modesty. In the mid-1860s, when he was in his early 60s and was collaborating with his editor, the Reverend William Kelly, in the preparation of his collected writings, Darby wrote a prefatory note to his earlier pamphlet of 1828, in which he indicated his jotting was the first germing of truth that has since developed itself in the Church of God. No, neither modesty nor Darby's own theology of the end times fully explains his obsessive personal secretiveness. Much of the explanation is wrapped in the hard shell of amber with which Darby protected himself from the world of mere humankind. Perhaps he had cauterized his own memory concerning his existence before becoming a prophet, or perhaps he believed that he had lived his true life only on the highest of spiritual planes, and that was the only way he wished to be remembered. Undeniably, however, even after one uncovers many of the facts of his background and life, there remains within the man a redoubt that the outsider cannot reach. Indeed, it is not clear that Darby could himself consciously access or control the innermost forces which animated him. In secular terms, John Nelson Darby had about as rich a familial and cultural background as one can imagine. He was born into a network of transatlantic commerce and influence that would provide access to some of the best minds and richest mercantile fortunes in the Atlantic world, if he decided to make use of these connections. And yet, Darby's family was also classically Anglo-Irish, in that over the 17th through the 19th centuries, its wide orbit of international activity rotated around a center point, Ireland. In this case, Kings County, present-day County Offaly, and the longtime family estate, Lepp Castle. Darby was born on the 18th of November, 1800, at 9 Great George Street, Westminster, London, to Anne, née Vaughan, Darby, 1757 to 1847, and John Darby, 1751 to 1834, whom, for convenience, if not strict etiquette, we will call John Darby, Sr. The lad was sent to Westminster School, London, as a boarder from 1812 to 1815, and entered Trinity College, Dublin, just before he turned 15. This was not an unusually early age, for universities in Ireland and England frequently took students who would today still be in secondary education. At the same time that young Darby studied for his TCD degree, he was enrolled on the books of King's Inn, Dublin, and began to engage in the ritual dining, two or three meals with senior members of the bar, over 9 terms in Ireland, and then 8 at an English inn, that was required at the time for entry into the legal profession at the top level. Apparently, he was intent on qualifying as an Irish barrister, which made sense. Historically, members of his family had qualified, sometimes in order to practice, but other times as a useful adjunct to estate management. Moreover, John Nelson's eldest sister, Susanna, had married in 1816 into the politically and legally powerful Penfather family, and her husband was on the way to becoming Chief Justice of the Irish Queen's Bench, and her brother-in-law to being Chief Baron of the Irish Court of Exchequer. Susanna Darby Penfather and her husband split their time between a rural estate in County Wicklow and a townhouse on Fitzwilliam Square, Dublin. By the time he was 18 years of age, John Nelson Darby was mixing, on terms of social familiarity, with some of the more powerful figures of the civic life of the Wicklow, South Dublin locale. To put into context Darby's early and easy access to the upper strata of Anglo-Irish society, we should first look at the associations he acquired through his mother. In terms of positive emotions, she was more important to him than was his father, and in any case, she brought to the Darby family a remarkable, internationally woven tapestry of culture and contacts. Her people, the Vaughans, like the Darbys, were of the caste of Protestant grabbers who had done well out of the 17th century reaving of Ireland. Originally Welsh, by 1800, the Vaughans were all over the map of the Atlantic world. The effective founder of the family's fortune was John Vaughan, 1572 to 1634, who had served in the Earl of Essex's Irish campaign of 1599 and had received an Irish peerage, the Earldom of Carberry, which went extinct after the third generation, and lands in Wales and in Ireland. By the mid-18th century, the Irish lands had been turned into Golden Grove, an estate in the same barony in King's County, where the Darby family resided. During the 18th century, the Vaughans were very good at prospecting around the transatlantic world. The key figure was the grandfather of John Nelson Darby, Samuel Freer Vaughan, 1720 to 1802, who had entered a London mercantile company as a youth and become the chief officer of a firm that traded in the provisioning and produce of the Jamaican slave economy. He married well, an American, Sarah Hallowell, who was not strictly an heiress, but whose extended family held 1.5 million acres of the best agricultural land in Maine. Samuel Freer Vaughan acquired 3 slave estates in Jamaica, and for a time was chief clerk of the Supreme Court of Jamaica. Samuel Vaughan and Sarah Hallowell had 4 sons and 6 daughters who survived to adulthood, among them the mother of John Nelson Darby, born in 1757, probably in London, although the family later moved to Philadelphia. Samuel, grandfather of John Nelson, was an extraordinary figure. On the American side of his trade network, He was friends with Benjamin Franklin, was acquainted with Thomas Jefferson, and idolized George Washington. He commissioned a Gilbert Stuart portrait of Washington that is now owned by the National Gallery in Washington, D.C., and he had a marble mantelpiece from his own London house sent to Mount Vernon, where it was placed in the banquet hall. Oh yes, and as a sideline, he was the chief designer of the gardens for what was later called Independence Square in Philadelphia. In the next generation, the brothers of Anne Vaughan, John Nelson Darby's uncles, formed a useful web of international influence. One brother, Samuel Vaughan the Younger, 1761 to 1827, ran the family slave plantations in Jamaica not very well. Another one, William, 1751 to 1850, a much brighter spark, was a fellow of the Royal Society, governor of the Royal Exchange Assurance Corporation, and one of the chief promoters of the commercial development of the London docks. Yet another, John, 1756 to 1841, was a wealthy gentleman wine merchant in Philadelphia and served as treasurer and librarian of the American Philosophical Society under Thomas Jefferson. The real meteor among the uncles of John Nelson Darby on his mother's side was Benjamin, 1751 to 1835, who, like his brother William, had been educated at Warrington Academy by Joseph Priestley, about as rigorous a schooling as one could obtain at the time. He was keen on the American Revolution, and through his family contacts became friends with Benjamin Franklin, and in 1779 edited a collection of Franklin's miscellaneous pieces. In the negotiations for the Treaty of Paris, Benjamin somehow became a confidential messenger for the British Prime Minister, Lord Shelburne, and also a secret agent for John Jay on behalf of the Americans. Still later, Benjamin became an MP for a rotten borough in Wiltshire and, after flirting with the French Revolution, retired to Halliwell, Maine, where he corresponded with six successive presidents of the United States and practiced medicine as a hobby. So when John Darby Sr. married Anne Vaughan in Trinity, Anglican Church, in New York, on the 21st of July, 1784, he was correctly betting that the Vaughan family connection would grow and be useful. The match had nothing to do with religion. Darby was a rationalistic Anglican, and Anne's family was mostly Unitarian or very arid Presbyterian. As a third son, it seemed he had little chance of inheriting Lepp Castle. That he did so in 1823 was the result of unlikely twists in the family's fortunes. Turning to transatlantic trading was a natural way to seek his fortune, the more so because within the Darby family he already had uncles in international commerce. Uncle, in the 18th century, covered a lot of familial relationships, and in this case, most likely reflects the Darby family's being intermarried with the D'Esters, a constellation of successful merchants and bankers with roots in Holland and in the Huguenot community. Hence, the continental contacts of his uncles and the network of the Vaughans in the Atlantic world, John Darby Sr. was well positioned to move into international trading and finance. The Darbys of Lepp Castle were not an ancient Irish family, but, by the mid-1700s, they were no longer parvenus. As invaders during the Cromwellian era, they had grabbed, not entirely successfully, lands in the King's County from the Ely O'Carrolls, including the best of the O'Carroll castles, a thick-walled, thoroughly defensible, remarkably ugly structure. A problem arose in the 1660s, however, because, as Catholics loyal to the crown, the O'Carrolls, after the Restoration, were entitled to receive most of their lands back. The Darbys were turned out for a time and only regained Lepp Castle in the 1690s, when the O'Carrolls supported James II against William of Orange. By the time the father of John Nelson Darby was born, the family had not only reacquired Lepp Castle, but had amassed over 4,000 acres. In large part, this was made possible by the 18th century penal code that helped to strip Catholics of most of their lands. The Darbys settled Protestant tenants around the castle as a bulwark against the bitter descendants of the former landholders, a policy that proved shrewd during the 1798 Rising, when the Protestant tenants and the Darby landlords mutually defended Lepp Castle and the homes of the surrounding tenants against the rebels. Although John Darby Sr. was a child of Lepp Castle, once he entered the international mercantile world, he followed the money and lived where he could most profit. By the time his youngest son, John Nelson, was born, he was a first-rank London trader. One must credit his success mostly to his own energy and attention to detail. Being one of his attorneys was a journey into perpetual micromanagement. And in part, his success was through his wife's family network in the West Indies and America, and in London itself. One of his wife's brothers was a founding director of the London Dock Company at Wapping. Moreover, the connections of the Darby family itself were also money-minting. One of John Darby Sr.'s older brothers was an admiral, and the senior Darby received victualling contracts for the fleet of Admiral Horatio Nelson. John Nelson Darby was christened at St. Margaret's, Westminster, on the 3rd of March, 1801. His middle name can be taken primarily as an indication of the friendship of Admiral Nelson with the brother of John Darby Sr., Henry d'Estaire Darby, and also as a token of commercial prudence that honored the source of a very profitable account. Pacey later folklore, the great admiral was not John Nelson's godfather. Now it is possible to grant that John Nelson and his father were not close. The senior Darby was nearly 50 years of age when John Nelson was born, and in any case, fathers of his social class usually did not spend a lot of time rolling around on the nursery floor. One can also accept that John Darby Sr. did not reside in Ireland. He inherited his childhood home, Lepp Castle, only in 1823, the third of three brothers to do so. And in the residential field, he was mostly attending to assembling a landed estate in Sussex. One should not bleach John Nelson of two pivotal, culturally determined characteristics. The first of these is that, although in his adult life he presented himself as autochthonous, virtually free of the inherited nostrums and ills of the tawdry secular world, he had an entire societal umbrella that simultaneously protected him from having to earn his own way in the world, and largely determined what he could and would do. He could never be a discalced pilgrim, even though in bursts of conversionist theater he sometimes presented himself as such. For example, during his time as a priest in Killarebog, County Wicklow, and a bit later as a young freelance pastor hiking through southern Ireland in clothes more suitable to a beggar than to a gentleman missioner. His rich family background precluded his ever being an unknown, just another humble servant of the Lord. And secondly, he was Anglo-Irish. His cosmopolitan associations were not at all unusual among the Anglo-Irish of his class, not quite the top class, but upper gentry. And his schooling in England before attending Trinity College Dublin and his enrolling for King's Inn, Dublin, were right out of the pattern book. As we shall hear in a moment, the crucial years of his spiritual formation in the 1820s and early 1830s were spent within the framework of the Church of Ireland, and although apparently John Nelson did not reside for any great length of time at Lepp Castle, that was still the center point of his family's social identity. His father was 72 years of age when he inherited the King's County estate, so it was not reasonable to expect him to move there. Nevertheless, the family church at Egunkin, near Lepp Castle, was where John Darby Sr. raised a heart-rendered monument to his eldest son, died 1809, and an affectionate monument to his own brother, died 1832. Equally tellingly, Lepp Castle went to the eldest surviving son, John Nelson's brother, William Henry Darby, when John Darby Sr. died in 1834. The English estate passed to a middle son. From the middle 1820s onward, the estate appears to have been managed by another of John Nelson's brothers, Horatio d'Estaire Darby. John Nelson got along well with both of these brothers, who controlled Lepp Castle. Indeed, William Henry became a disciple of John Nelson and led a Darbyite brethren congregation at the castle, the basis of which was his 13 children by 2 wives. There is no question that in his adult years, Lepp Castle was one of the few fixed this-world location points on the mental map of the peripatetic John Nelson. Most of the other points were in another world entirely. Darby's spiritual development during the 1820s and early 1830s was often tortured, was sometimes so slow to occur that it appeared non-existent, and then, at moments, proceeded with head-snapping acceleration. The key to the formation of his spiritual personality is that it took place within the framework of the Church of Ireland. John Nelson Darby was, at first, a keen, strict churchman, and then a virulent opponent of the Anglican establishment in Ireland. In his successive guises, it was the Irish Church that was, first, the citadel that he energetically defended, and then, even more strongly attacked. The simple, almost ballistic nature of Darby's reversal of his position concerning the Church of Ireland should not, however, be described as being symmetrical conceptually. He first wrapped himself in the faith of the Book of Common Prayer, and then rejected it. But he did not mechanically turn his Anglican faith inside out, as if it were a glove. By the mid-1830s, he was deeply in disagreement with many of the basic doctrines of the Church of Ireland, and especially unhappy with the Church's organizational methods, its ecclesiology, and its view of the future of humankind, its eschatology. And more obliquely, he was willing to niggle on almost every issue of detail, particularly if this involved the interpretation of a portion of Scripture. Yet, on the baseline issue of the redeeming power of the Almighty as affected through Jesus of Nazareth, he remained aligned with traditional church doctrine. In the long run, the commonalities he held with the main forms of Protestantism in the British Isles made him more of a danger to the existing Protestant denominations, and most especially to the Anglican faith in Ireland and in England, than if he had been a proponent of the much-feared Oxford movement that was said to be a stalking horse for the Church of Rome. Darby's conversion, in 1820 or 1821, he forgot when, was one of the many critical events in his life that he all but erased from his papers and, indeed, may have largely erased from his own memory. His conversion may have been one of the low-temperature, largely private products of personal study and meditation that were common among the Anglo-Irish evangelicals of the period, or he may have been led by someone. Darby, in later life, credited no living person with helping him. In midlife, he referred to the biblical essays of the Reverend Thomas Scott, 1747 to 1821, as being helpful. But this notice seems to have been retrospected at a time Darby was doing his own biblical concordance. A reasonable speculation is that the young Darby, barely out of his teens, was strongly influenced by the cadre of socially elite evangelicals who had their country houses in Wicklow and townhouses on the residential squares of Southside Dublin. If so, he later had every reason to wipe the slate clean, for he subsequently turned vitriolically against the evangelicals within the established church. It is hard to know what Darby did between 1819 and 1825, save live the life of a privileged but very serious young gentleman. In 1819, in his last term at TCD, he won a gold medal in classics, a competitive prize given mostly for linguistic memorization. Darby's gift for languages served him very well in his adult career, for besides Greek, Latin, and Hebrew, he acquired fluent French and very good German and serviceable Italian. He preached and wrote in the modern languages and translated from ancient texts to modern. It is certain that in 1819 to 1822, he ate the requisite number of dinners at Lincoln's Inn, London, and then was admitted to the degree of barrister of King's Inn, Dublin. He was an accredited lawyer in Ireland, but it is unclear if he ever practiced. The flag point, the indication that something more than quiet personal faith was digging into the mind of John Nelson Darby, is a simple receipt from a Dublin tailor dated 9th December, 1824. It is for the making of a clergyman's gown. Darby was determined to enter the priesthood. Darby's development between his conversion in 1820 or 1821 and his commitment in late 1824 to become a clergyman of the Church of Ireland is one of the many things over which Darby himself draws a veil. We can, however, at least know the context. A strong social-religious set operated within the Anglo-Irish elite of County Wicklow and South County Dublin, the people with whom Darby through his family was most closely acquainted. Large estates, morning prayers, evangelical societies, pious houseguests, intense study of Scripture, informed awareness of the Church Fathers, and, all around, big personalities. Of these personalities, two that Darby knew well were the Reverend Robert Daly and Viscountess Powerscourt. Daly was a rector of Powerscourt Parish, which was arguably the plum parish in all of Ireland. A man of immense energy, huge enthusiasm for evangelical proselytizing societies, and an ability to face down his own religious superiors if they obstructed his work, he was especially good at converting the very rich to evangelical Anglicanism. He was on social terms with Darby while the latter was still an undergraduate at Trinity. The other big personality, Theodosia, nay Howard, Wingfield, Lady Powerscourt, was a widow's weeds figure, pale, with an almost tubercular visage framed in the black of her social station. Her husband, Richard Wingfield, 5th Viscount Powerscourt, had died in August 1823. He had left the young relic, born 1820, the same year as Darby, as chatelaine during the minority of the 6th Viscount of a massive house situated on a landscaped demesne of more than 800 acres, part of a general landholding of approximately 49,000 acres. She had been converted by the Reverend Mr. Daly and combined an extremely rich spiritual life, as attested by her posthumously published letters, with an almost shy recognition of her very superior social position. The degree to which these two figures influenced Darby directly is indeterminate. Undeniably, however, they and the other members of the evangelical Freemasonry of the Anglican elite determined the ambient religious values that young Darby encountered as he poked about, trying to decide whether to spend his life as a barrister or as something else. What is clear is that once Darby had committed to entering the church as his profession, he was very carefully groomed. That is not to say that he was rigorously examined or trained. Although Trinity College Dublin had a divinity school, at this time it was largely a holding tank for young graduates passing time until they reached the canonical age of 24. It was almost an insult to require well-connected, well-educated men such as Darby to take any formal training, and he was ordained deacon on the 7th of August, 1825, without any institutional certification, although he did take the counsel of an unspecified spiritual advisor. Rather quickly thereafter, on the 19th of February, 1826, he was priested. Darby was a prize, a potential bishop, or at least the dean of a major cathedral in the making. The way the club took care of him was unambiguous. The Archbishop of Dublin, William McGee, had no parish to give him, but he did a whip-round of the senior clergy of County Wicklow and convinced four of them that young Darby was just the right sort of chap, and wouldn't they please pay his dues for the first few years, just until he came into his own benefice. So they did. Four benefice holders chipped in a total of £75, 7 shillings, 8 pennies annually, and a new curacy for Killary, County Wicklow, was created. The post mostly encompassed Bog Island. It had no rectory, and a schoolhouse had to be used for worship. In theory, Darby reported to the Reverend William Cleaver of Delgany. In practice, at an unusually young age, he was his own man. Giving young Darby a large degree of independence was a gamble, but the risk was tempered by his isolation. He really was a long walk from anywhere, that, within the then values of the Church of Ireland, the bet was worth making, stemmed not only from Darby's being very smart and richly connected socially, he was also very keen on the Second Reformation movement and actually believed that Ireland could be converted to Protestantism. Further, sending him to the back of nowhere laid off two risks. Darby was still very young, and young clerics can be volatile, especially those without a wife and children to remind them to answer softly to their superiors. Moreover, he had taken up a form of strict churchmanship, fasting a minimum of once a week, no meat in Lent, going about at times in monkish garb and at other times as a virtual beggar, taking communion only after seeking the approval of his spiritual advisor, and more. Paradoxically, in the 1820s, these devotions were less unsettling in the Church of Ireland than were parallel practices in the Church of England. The depth of Ireland's sectarian fissure meant that however strict church a cleric became, almost certainly he was not going to jump from Anglicanism to Roman Catholicism. Darby was unimpeachably anti-Catholic. Still, his sponsors hoped that a few years in Killary's squelching wetness and not a single educated soul in the parish to talk to would knock the medieval romanticism out of him and help young Darby to see the value of dry boots, a good horse and carriage, and a warm rectory. In the actual event, any chance of the Reverend John Nelson Darby's becoming a solid and stolid Church of Ireland clergyman soon disappeared. Late in 1827, he had what was referred to as a riding accident, although it was nothing quite so tony. His horse ran him into a stable's doorpost, and Darby smashed his knee certainly, and possibly his head. Stables in the countryside had very low doors, and getting through one, while mounted, was a danger in even the best of situations. He retired to convalesce at the Dublin and County Wicklow homes of his sister, Susanna, and her husband. In the period December 1827 to February 1828, he had some deep apperceptions and made some decisions that turned his life in new directions. This time of deep reflection should not be equated with the Apostle Paul's suddenly seeing a pure light that totally turned his life around. Darby altered his path much more slowly. He took the better part of a decade to articulate his new views. The key is that in his convalescence, he had time to read, think, pray, and especially to pay critical attention to what was happening in the Church of Ireland as it foundered under the weight of the Second Reformation movement. In his diagnostic, we briefly see Darby's mind in a rare moment of transparency, and very contradictory it was. First, he correctly recognized that the Second Reformation had become a failure. He did not, however, understand that it had been a foolish and ill-fated crusade from its very beginning, and he certainly did not realize that in the 1820s, Catholic Ireland was inevitably and inexorably on the rise. Secondly, perversely, he concluded that the attempt to convert Catholics actually had been going along very well until recently. In later life, he asserted that 600 to 800 Catholics were being converted each week, a logarithmic exaggeration, for even the most inflated numbers from the several proselytizing agencies claimed at most only 2,400 total conversions annually. Here, one sees quite clearly an ability that facilitated Darby's metamorphosis into a full-scale prophet, namely, the mental power to reject everyday verifiable reality. Thirdly, Darby then explained why the non-existent phenomenon, the ongoing mass conversion of Catholics, and thus the transformation of Ireland into a Protestant country, had been stopped in its tracks. It was the fault of Archbishop McGee, the prelate who had gone so far out of his way to create the Killary curacy for Darby. The details of Darby's non-factual attack on McGee are not here worth detailing. The salient point for understanding the later Darby is that very early in his career, he showed himself to be an instinctive and very nasty blame-caster. Indeed, throughout his entire life, he seemed unable to deal with cause and effect in the everyday world. Almost always, when something happened that he either did not understand or did not approve, he personalized things. He found somebody to blame. This habit of mind, personalizing and blame-casting, fit well with the register of a true prophet, constantly on edge, shrill, unpleasant, but not in every case wrong. Upon recovery, Darby went AWOL from his parish. He never formally resigned. He was replaced in 1831, and the post turned into a perpetual curacy. A church was built in 1834. According to friends, Darby stopped reading virtually everything except the Bible. He turned himself into a freelance missioner, marching several times across Ireland. Darby's physical stamina was remarked on throughout his life, and it was not an incidental gift. Visiting front-edge Anglican evangelicals in the universities of England and searching for kindred souls on the continent. So much was going on in his mind, he had to turn aright a world that, in his view, had been turned upside down. That John Nelson Darby would find the answer in the Bible to the problems that beset his world was easily predictable. What is intriguing is the sequencing of the issues that he held up to Holy Writ for illumination and the way he employed the Bible. These two aspects of his thought, the prioritization of issues and the development of an hermeneutic, channeled the way his mind developed from the mid-1820s, when he was priested, into the mid-1830s. Surprisingly, what bothered Darby most was church organization, ecclesiology in the theological, not the architectural, sense of that term. He was more than merely niggled by the failure of the Second Reformation and by the actions of Archbishop William McGee, and even more so by his successor, Richard Whately, whom Darby denounced as a Sabellian, an insult more hurtful in the early 19th century than in our own times. As mentioned earlier, Darby, to a remarkable degree, personalized matters. So, it fits well with this habit of mind that the first place his adhesion to Anglicanism began to slip was on the issue of the proper nature of Christian organization. If the church structure was being determined by people whom he faulted, then it followed that not only they, but the entire Church of Ireland was riven by deep spiritual fractures. Here, he drew on a bank of earnest, evangelical men and a few women of his own age in Dublin who were keen not only to ask if the Anglican Church was truly Christian, but also whether any of the formal churches of Christendom were legitimate. Beginning in 1825, the dating is somewhat foggy, but the phenomenon was certainly real. A small number of individuals who affirmed that they had experienced conversion and some form of a visitation by the Holy Spirit began to meet together in Dublin and Wicklow for Bible readings, extempore prayers, and self-preached sermons, and, crucially, to break bread. That is, to celebrate a form of Christian communion that was modeled, they believed, on the practice of the earliest Christians. This exercise did not require an ordained minister to officiate, or, indeed, any clergyman to be present, although one or two often might be. The site was not a church, and most often was the drawing room of a genteel house. Taken together, these tiny house churches were the embryonic Brethren. The name is a problem. More of that in a moment. Historically, these practitioners are sometimes called Earlies, or they can be termed Proto-Brethren. By 1829, several of the tiny cells had coalesced into a Dublin group that worshipped first at the Fitzwilliam Square residence of Francis Synge Hutchinson, and then, in 1830, in a rented space in an auction house in Anger Street, Dublin, the rent for which was paid by John Veazey Parnell. In one of the mildly messianic beliefs Darby came to entertain about himself, in his 70s, he wrote to a follower concerning events in 1828. I was myself the beginning of what the world calls Plymouth Brethren, though we began in Dublin. Earlier in his 60s, Darby had written to his longtime ally, John Gifford Bellett. It was no small thing to me that you, with dear C., Edward Cronin, and H., Francis Synge Hutchinson, were one of the first four who, with me, through God's grace, the fourth, began to break bread in Dublin. At least Darby had the Dublin part right, for that is where the foundation stone for the Brethren was laid. Actually, in the immediate case, the men he mentions, and several others, had been in bread-breaking house churches prior to Darby's big moment. Also, like several of the earliest Brethren, for a long time, Darby kept one foot in the Anglican camp. It is noteworthy that when, in the late autumn of 1832, Lady Powerscourt definitively left the Church of Ireland and limited her communal worship to the Anger Street Assembly, Darby did not follow her. Until mid-1834, he was still tethered, however tenuously, to the Church of Ireland. Despite Darby's false memory concerning his founding of the Brethren, in the late 1820s he was, like several of the other Earlies, engaged in a deep dive into biblical history. Their goal, as far as proper church organization was concerned, had as much to do with the practice of worship as it did with abstract theology. At this juncture, sanctified orthopraxy was the goal. The full filigree of orthodoxy would follow. The unstated algorithm was this: praying, studying, discoursing, and worshiping in the manner of the primitive church would inexorably lead toward a replication of the beliefs of the earliest church. Respect for this equation is crucial, historically, for everyday practice, based on inferred ancient patterns, had to be sorted out before the more arcane manners of Christology and, especially, prophecies of the future could be articulated. One of the most interesting things about the way in which Darby's interpretations of prophetic scripture emerged is that his development of dispensationalism was a result of his disaffection with the ecclesiastical status quo. Eschatology followed on from church doctrine. This shrewd observation was made by Mark Sweetnam and Crawford Gribben and is summarized as follows. It was ecclesiological concern that led to Darby's rethinking of prophecy. If, for the sake of economy, we summarize the emerging ecclesiological development of the early brethren, a complex and messy affair in its details, two massive questions had to be faced. The first was the very awkward one that has so long bothered most schools of Christianity, namely, whether or not the Hebrew Scriptures provide patterns of organizational structure and behavior which Christians should in some way emulate. And secondly, does the New Testament contain enough historical information to serve as a set of plans for the true Christian church? On the first issue, the early assemblies embraced both ambiguity and simplicity, an unusual mix. On the one hand, they were fully willing to assimilate the primary organizational center of the ancient Israelites, the Jerusalem Temple. In the late 1820s and the 1830s, the men and women who were so disappointed with the Church of Ireland were affirming their own version of the so-called Third Temple, initially as a spiritual space in ordinary time and finally as a real item, part of their prophetic scenario of the end times. Yet, in contradiction, the early brethren rejected the long-standing idea that the Christian church evolved from the same covenant that had produced ancient Judaism. This move on their part was radical to the point of being revolutionary, and in practice, it meant that they were not bound by any ancient Israelite imperative to honor an hierarchical organization or to respect a professional priesthood. That simplified everything. The New Testament, in contrast, was interpreted as presenting information on organizational structure that was normative for all subsequent generations of believers. If one believed that the church of the present day had failed, specifically in this instance that the Church of Ireland was a failure, then the New Testament indeed was the place to seek the blueprint for reconstruction. Crucially, the earlies locked into a sophisticated form of literalism that played directly into their later, fully articulated theology. They asked, how did the early Christians arrange themselves once Jesus of Nazareth was no longer with them? The pattern of organization, often called the primitive church, was taken as normative. More than the Gospels, which focus upon Jesus, the Acts of the Apostles was studied for material on church practices. The letters of Paul were also useful, if read closely, but the historical authenticity of the other books of the New Testament, the several Catholic epistles, and the Revelation of St. John, had all been questioned by some of the early church fathers. A possible reaction to the uneasy canonicity of such parts of the New Testament might have been for Darby and his colleagues to define a stratigraphy of textual authenticity and then to follow only the data on the basic level. Instead, the entire New Testament was affirmed as being of divine authority and each part as equally inspired as any other. Further, the scriptures were to be read literally, a massively consequential decision. Because literalism in reading the Bible is such a landmine issue in present-day evangelicalism, and indeed in American civic debate, we must be clear that it was not nearly so explosive in its early stages among Irish Protestants, divisive though it was. The earlies were employing literalism in the first instance to tell them how to organize their own devotional fellowship. Granted, to follow the primitive church pattern was controversial within established church circles and was pregnant with implications concerning the Christian sacraments. However, even when applied to such things as the creation story, literalism was not the big issue it became later in the 19th century, when the geological and the Darwinian arguments over the inception of world history took center stage. Moreover, members of the 1820s generation of Irish evangelicals, some became full brethren, most stayed Anglican, were technically skilled in their approach to the scriptures, especially the New Testament. Almost all of the male participants in the discussions were competent in classical Greek and Latin, and many had serviceable Hebrew. They were not simple-minded. They understood that no translation of the original biblical documents was completely accurate, so they worked very hard at philology and on uncovering the divine kernel within the husk of the text. This was done with immense respect for the material, and while affirming that the entire canonical text, in its original holographic form, was of divine origin and was to be read as fact. In the long run, the unflinching biblicism that was honed in the search for an alternative pattern to the ecclesiology of the Church of Ireland turned out to have as much influence on questions of individual salvation and on the definition of the Almighty's plan for the future as it did on strictly organizational matters. Two hermeneutic commandments became the law and the prophets for the brethren. These were not mottos that, like some wall-mounted sampler, everyone looked at and then went their own way. These were matters of technique defined in the practice of constant, watchful group Bible studies and devotional discussions. Inevitably, the historians putting into words a summary of the early brethren pattern of repetitive behavior sounds too casual, too epigrammatic, too compressed to accurately reflect the acts of daily devotion that were the searchings of the scriptures. Nevertheless, words are required. The two hermeneutic commandments developed in the late 1820s and early 1830s were to 1. Read the text literally, and even when dealing with allegories, tropes, and typologies, understand that somehow it all is literal, and to 2. Read imaginatively, since every passage in the scripture is of divine origin and authority, and hence equal in authority with every other one, move passages around and consider placing distant verses close to each other. Do that prayerfully, and always with the goal of finding the original intention of the Almighty. Find the Bible within the Bible. As for the immediate matter of church organization, from the middle 1820s to the mid-1830s, the earlies were uncomfortable with the Anglican Church in Ireland, but also were uneasy about breaking with it. An interesting litmus item is that until the mid-1830s, most assemblies did not schedule their Sunday bread-breaking for a time that clashed with the services of the local Church of Ireland place of worship. Using the New Testament as their guide, early brethren worked their way to a position in which there was no external authority over a local assembly, no relationship with the state, no priests, although a variety of special skills were recognized, no sacraments that could be construed as mechanical conduits of divine grace, yet the collective fellowship of believers in Bible study, and especially in the breaking of bread, was somehow Holy Spirit-blessed. These and related matters were in flux as the brethren grew in the British Isles, but always the discussion came back to deciphering the blueprints contained within the New Testament. Here, one must mention a matter of some historical uncertainty concerning brethren ecclesiology. At some point, the early brethren in Ireland and their counterparts in Great Britain passed from being a tiny collection of cells into something more. A set of alliances was formed among the scattered assemblies, and this certainly resembles an organization, despite the frequent assertion that, no, we are only a constellation of spirit-led, voluntary meetings of believers and have no structure, only shared faith. Thus, two vexed questions. What does one call the people in their faith set? And when can one say they coalesced into an identifiable entity? For the most part, they hated names. They were willing to be called Christians, and usually brethren, and the latter term is preferred here. I do not believe at present one can put up an historical plaque with a brethren founding date cast in bronze, but if a date really is needed, the following alternatives seem of equal value. One may choose June 1838, when an almost 3 weeks long set of meetings was held at the Gloucester Hotel in Clifton, near Bristol, and this clearly marked the Brethren as a British Isles-wide group and one whose center of excitement had shifted from Ireland to England. A second choice is September 1833, when a very select band of early Brethren held a famous Garden House Communion during Lady Powerscourt's third big prophetic house party. Third, one could opt for the autumn of 1832, when the increasingly tattered alliance of Wicklow and South Dublin Anglican evangelicals broke up, and Viscountess Powerscourt decided soon thereafter to leave the Church of Ireland, and simultaneously inaugurating a new era in Brethren history. A fourth acceptable date is May 1830, when the Dublin-Wicklow proto-Brethren engaged in the rental of a secular space in Anger Street, Dublin, for their continuing weekly worship. Fifth, the earliest plausible moment would be November 1829, when Francis Synge Hutchinson put his Fitzwilliam Square residence at the disposal of the Earlies as a place of regular assembly. Manifestly, it is difficult, and perhaps a bit silly and maybe disrespectful, to try to pin down the earliest organizational history of men and women who held that they were not an organization. The earliest Brethren ecclesiology dictated a refusal of self-labels that were sectarian, meaning, roughly, denominational. And if Christian was preferred, by the late 1830s, most affiliates were willing to use the term Brethren in referring specifically to one another and also to their assemblies. But of course, in the same period, almost every continental country and principality had conventicles that broke away from the several state churches and whose names frequently were Englished as Brethren, sometimes with a prefix. For example, the Moravian Brethren. Sometimes not. This can lead to confusion when dealing historically with aggregate information. How many Brethren were there in England in 1851? Equally, in countries where national enumerations were conducted in which individual by individual data were collected on religious faith, Canada is the best example. The historian has to be careful not to conflate those with roots in the British Isles with quite different Brethren from the continent. If only an historically accurate and distinct name had come into use, Wicklow Brethren or Dublin Brethren would have been usefully distinctive and would have accurately reflected the group's foundational history. However, by the late 1830s, the religious press in the British Isles was often using the label Plymouth Brethren, and, while still refusing to adopt any worldly name when speaking among themselves, the increasingly common Plymouth term was grudgingly accepted by Brethren when dealing with outsiders. John Nelson Darby's explanation was that Plymouth, being the place where most of the publications originated, the name Plymouth Brethren became the usual appellation given to such meetings. There was more to it than that, for Plymouth, after the Wicklow-Dublin constituency, became the second metropole of early Brethrenism, benefiting in part from what is known as the Western Schism, initiated by radical evangelicals in the Church of England. By 1832, there probably were more adherents to the early form of Brethrenism in Plymouth and Bristol than in Ireland, and Darby found great comfort in visiting Plymouth in that year. An intriguing aspect of the term, Plymouth Brethren, is that when, in the 1860s and 1870s, Darby was spending most of his time in missionary work in the United States and Canada, he became increasingly willing to accept the association with Plymouth, England. In line with Darby's development, the generality of brethren in North America found it useful in public to be associated, quite misleadingly, with the 17th-century Mayflower founders of the Plymouth colony. The faux association with the separatists among the Pilgrim Fathers conferred a fuzzy historical antiquity upon the Brethren that played well in both the USA and in the Protestant parts of Canada. For the purposes of our compressed review of the early career of John Nelson Darby, a pivotal time was October 1831, when Lady Powerscourt held the first of her epical prophetic house parties. This, then, is the apposite moment to note a central point about the way we are looking at Darby and his formative power in world evangelicalism, an influence that still operates approaching two centuries later. The importance of his life is dependent on a variety of amplifiers, words that alert us to this phenomenon: magnification, resonance, harmonics, plangency, are all ways of indicating that Darby's practices and beliefs gathered international force only because they keyed a sympathetic vibration in preachers, Bible students, missionaries, congregations, and evangelical crusaders. Of course, his own set of brethren was responsive to his mind and his will, but crucially, persons whom Darby had not himself in any way colonized, and most of whose names he never would know, became resonators of his work. That is why it is no immediate tragedy, in my view, that we do not know enough about Darby to present a satisfactorily deep biography. It will be done someday. For now, recognition of the pervasive import and the complex mechanics of Darbyism, taken to mean the sum total of his influence, is much more useful than the construction of a day-to-day chronicle of Darby's life would be, even if it were immediately possible. In the present study, a good deal of new material about Darby himself is presented. But Darby the man is employed as an entrepot for the appreciation of larger religious phenomena. Lady Powerscourt's first prophetic house party, the 3rd through the 7th of October 1831, was a serious religious occasion, and among the pious, it also was one of the social events of the year. It often seems to be God's way to begin with the upper classes to raise up a testimony before kings and rulers. This was the summary of the history of the Powerscourt events that was taught to Miss Anna M. Stoney, a third-generation member of an upper gentry Tipperary family of longtime Darby loyalists. Her grandmother was so keen on the prophetic meetings of the 1830s that she shut up her country house and took a cottage on the Powerscourt demesne. Powerscourt House was a remarkably immodest Palladian monument to the glory of humankind. It was a mid-18th-century design of Richard Castle's, whose works included Leinster House, now the home of the Parliament of the Republic of Ireland. The house was so large that present-day architectural historians are unable to ascertain exactly how many rooms it contained in the era of the spiritual house parties. 68 is a good guess, but there may have been more. The grand ballroom was 60 feet long, 40 feet wide, and had a 40-foot-high ceiling. Amidst the wainscoting, painted panels and ceiling, marble busts and portraits, sat the throne that had been carved for King George IV's visit to Powerscourt in August 1821. Powerscourt House, then, was a suitable place for important religious discussions, and one likely to bring out the self-importance in all but the most humble of its participants. Powerscourt House, as imposing a big house as existed in Ireland, potentially was a massive amplification chamber. In the 1831 meeting, however, it was prevented from serving as an amphitheater of enthusiasm and stridency by two muffling blankets, one social, the other involving the terms of debate. On the social level, the meeting was held under the conventions of aristocratic propriety. Lady Powerscourt had several guests in residence for the events, including close social friends, leading Anglican evangelical clergy, and particularly pious gentry from South Dublin. The local gentry were invited as day guests, and a substantial number of her own yeoman tenants attended as observers. The actual total attendance is unknown, but the debates were dominated by the 35 Church of Ireland clergymen present and the 15 selected laymen. About a score of ladies were present as house guests, and they helped to keep the tone civil, even though they did not participate in the discussions. A certain amount of forbearance was required on the part of the Powerscourt staff, for the affair worked like one of the faux medieval festivals that were popular at the time in the British Isles. The lower orders were permitted in limited numbers to attend, as long as they were quiet and kept their place. Secondly, and crucially, the undisputed Anglican evangelical leader among the Anglo-Irish ascendancy of Wicklow and South Dublin, Robert Daly, rector of Powerscourt Parish, was in the chair. The grand ballroom did not become an echo chamber for the shrill and quarrelsome because he imposed some very clear conventions. In the formal meetings, participants were restricted to reading prepared statements on the questions of the day. Direct debate and contradictory argument were not permitted. Sessions of private prayer were held in side rooms, and deep discussions of biblical interpretation were engaged during long walks on the Powerscourt grounds. Politesse reigned. John Nelson Darby participated, but he did not raise his voice. The 1831 Powerscourt Conference and its successors were not the first of their sort. The initial Irish Residential Conference on Prophecy and Related Matters had been held in March 1829 in the far west of Ireland by the young evangelical Reverend Edward Synge, 1798-1859, curate to the Archdeacon of Tuam and a relative of the Synges who were central to the evangelical movement in Wicklow and South Dublin. Of greater force as a precedent was the series of house parties at Albury Park, Surrey, hosted by Henry Drummond, 1786-1860, heir to a London private banking fortune, a political and social eccentric, and a spiritual adventurer. From 1826 to 1830, inclusive, Drummond gathered the top names in English prophetic speculation for week-long annual meetings at his estate. The actual dogwork of getting 40 male egos into the same venue was the task of the young local rector, the Reverend Hugh McNeil, 1795-1879, a gifted graduate of TCD who had possessed the good career sense to wed the daughter of William McGee, Archbishop of Dublin. Lady Powerscourt attended the inaugural Albury Park Symposium, although as a woman she was not recognized as really being there. And the Albury pattern seems to have been the model she adopted for her own 1831 house party. Despite, however, the influence of the initial Albury Park house parties on Lady Powerscourt, the wider impact of the Albury meetings was self-negating, largely because of their diffuse and unrecorded results and association with publicly embarrassing forms of spirituality. In contrast, the Powerscourt house parties became a consciously imitated precedent, first by the conferences begun in the later 1850s in Barnet, London, which evolved into the Mild May, Islington, London, Second Advent conferences held in 1878, 1879, and 1886 through the initiative of Reverend William Penfather, an Anglican priest and a nephew by marriage of John Nelson Darby. Secondly, in annual conferences in Guelph, Ontario, which began in the 1860s and starred Darby, and then, In a knock-on effect occurred the seminal Niagara Conferences, which were formalized in 1883 and were held annually until 1897 at Niagara-on-the-Lake in Ontario. Also, there were several evanescent prophet congresses on both sides of the Atlantic in the High Victorian era, but Mildmay, Guelph, and Niagara were the heavy iron links running from the Powers Court discussions to modern evangelical thought concerning God's future reign. What were the subjects of the formal papers which the Reverend Robert Daly insisted be the guarantor of decorum at the 1831 Powers Court house party? The sequence of discussion followed no formal logic, but nevertheless was revealing as a catalogue of concerns that weighed on the minds of the most committed of Anglican evangelicals in the immediate backwash of the failure of the Second Reformation in Ireland and of the granting of Catholic emancipation. The first topic, taken up in the evening of Monday, the 3rd of October, was signaled as the gifts of the Spirit to be considered. This topic raised substantial matters, albeit slightly encoded ones. Many of the conferees believed in the possibility of a special personal blessing from the Holy Spirit, but equally, they were adamantly against indecorous gifts, most especially the speaking in tongues outbreak that had been taking place in London and in several places in Scotland. The tongues were decried as being a sign of Irvingism, associated with the London congregation of the Reverend Edward Irving, who in fact was somewhat bewildered by the tongues phenomenon. That these concerns about gifts were of secondary importance, however, is clear from their being the first item on the schedule, to be taken up at 6 in the afternoon on the opening Monday. The laity at the conference were the sort who took the usual Friday through Monday for recreation, and the clergy, of course, were engaged on Sunday. The social reality was that many of the significant guests would have spent the day traveling and well might have arrived later in the evening. The following full 4 days, however, were given over chiefly to interpreting biblical prophecies. Crucially, the 4-day discussion of prophecy by these front-edge Irish evangelicals allows us to make a pivotal observation. Although biblical prophecy always had been a side interest of Christian theologues, the idea that the return of Jesus Christ, as mentioned in the Scriptures, was to be taken as a literal prophecy of his actual physical return to earth in his original bodily form was so fresh, so minority minted, that it was revolutionary. The idea simply was not part of Christian doctrine, generally conceived. If, in 1800, one had put forward the idea that a primary purpose of the Old and New Testaments was to show the course of future events leading to Jesus' physical return and to the end times of all eternity, then all but the most outré sector of the Protestant world would have rejected the idea as being either heretical or lunatic. It is a measure of the rise of prophetic Protestant evangelicalism, which justifiably could be termed the Second Protestant Reformation, that between the French Revolution and 1830, it became possible for some of the best-trained, most nimble minds in the British Isles to beaver away at telling the future from texts that were scripted millennia in the past. Not that Jesus' second coming had been rejected in post-patristic theology, but it usually had been interpreted either as an allegory for God's final judgment or as occurring through an undefined, larger-than-life cosmic figure finally subsuming the temporary disorder that reigned on earth. Now, in the new view, Jesus was to return in the flesh and to rule for a millennium over planet Earth and then over the entire cosmos. One notes the tone of surprise and the arched eyebrows of a writer in the Christian Examiner and Church of Ireland magazine in 1829. The notion of the personal advent of Christ to reign with his saints upon earth for 1,000 years is becoming, if we might so express ourselves, absolutely fashionable. It was all so very new. Relative to the standard Protestant position, the Irish evangelicals of Lady Powerscourt's gathering were front edge. The selective nature of her guest list meant that most of the invited participants were pre-sold on the idea of the second advent of Jesus as being a literal, physical event, and an apocalyptic one. It was not going to arrive as the happy culmination of a long period of increasing righteousness on the earth, but with a crash, an interruption of the ever more evil forces which were overpowering human society, especially Ireland. The church and the world are like tumbled drawers, was Lady Powerscourt's view. Given that there would be an apocalyptic second coming of Jesus, the next question was, would it end all human time with a single explosive event, or would time be metered out between the second advent and God's final judgment? Most probably, the majority at Powerscourt favored the idea of some sort of time gap, the millennium being its most literal label. They also debated whether there would be one final resurrection or two, and very divisively could one predict with any degree of accuracy when the second coming would take place. In other words, were the scriptures prophetically parsable as to the date of future events, or were believers to sit permanently on a knife's edge, wondering whether the next minute would be the last moment of human time? These and many other questions rattled back and forth in the grand ballroom of Powerscourt, and they all made some degree of sense, provided that one believed that Jesus of Nazareth, in physical form, would indeed return again to earth. Because the apocalyptic aspects of the new evangelicalism were, and still are, so attention-grabbing, they can sometimes obscure bedrock matters of personal faith and of fellowship with fellow believers. The devotees spent a great deal of time in intensive Bible study, wrestling with questions that long had been central to Christian theology. How did salvation work? How was the work of Jesus accomplished, and what was the nature of his divinity? If salvation came through faith, what was the second level of blessing that came to the truly devout as a gift of the Holy Spirit? And certainly, gifts of the Spirit did exist for the core believers. In long, extempore prayers, eyes tightly shut, the early brethren raised petitions to the Almighty for true gifts, petitions repeated time and time again. The more radical of the still young evangelicals, most were barely into their 30s, asked for a special gift, sometimes called a seal or a sealing of the Holy Spirit, and they prayed to be granted a vocation for teaching or preaching or divining biblical messages, whatever the Holy Spirit vouchsafed. This general caution against misperceiving the emergent brethren as merely an apocalyptic cult being assimilated, it is undeniable that the one gift, among several, that distinguished the early brethren was prophecy. William H. Oliver rightly observed concerning the situation in England that the students of prophecy saw themselves as prophets. That characteristic held even more strongly for the front-edge Wicklow-Dublin evangelicals who, having attended Lady Powerscourt's first prophetic house party in 1831, reconvened in an annual series of residential meetings from 1832 through 1836. The details of those events are only partially visible, but four strands of an overall pattern are clear. First, the ideological orbit of the dominant members of the prophets became more and more elliptical until it finally gyred completely away from Orthodox Anglicanism. Secondly, the direct influence of full-time, older professional Church of Ireland clergymen within the prophetic cohort diminished greatly. The key date was 1832, when the Reverend Robert Daly, having chaired a fractious week of meetings, heartbrokenly washed his hands of the Powers Court Prophecy School. Thirdly, laymen increasingly came to the fore, Darby as a clergyman being the chief exception, and in any case, by the mid-1830s, he had become something like a reconstituted layperson. Fourthly, the level of social exclusiveness of the prophetic gatherings declined. One could graph the decline easily by noting locales. The events of 1832 and 1833 were still house parties at the Powers Court estate in Wicklow. In 1834 and 1835, they were held in the smaller but still prestigious Powers Court townhouse in Dublin. And in 1836, the event took place in a South Dublin hotel. There, the Irish conferences ended. By 1838, the major prophetic meetings were being held in England in public hotels with a respectable, but no longer tony band of exegetes and prophetic enthusiasts. The 1832 house party assembled on Monday evening, the 24th of September, and, like its predecessor, ran until late Friday afternoon. One would have predicted that it would stay within the same boundaries as the 1831 meeting. The Reverend Robert Daly was still the formal chairman, and the menu of discussion had the same two basic items on it: prophetic interpretation and the gifts of the Spirit. The way the latter item was dealt with probably should have been a big step toward peace, order, and good government. The early brethren, especially Darby, fiercely protected their turf against the distraction of what they called Irvingism. This was associated with certain spiritual gifts of which they did not approve, primarily speaking in tongues. One can think of the Irvingites in this regard as being proto-Pentecostals. They had to be stamped out, but so too did the Irvingites' rivalry with the early brethren over who owned the radical prophecy franchise. At the 1832 Powers Court gathering, several Irvingites in attendance were routed. The power of the Holy Spirit was elucidated at length. Given that utterances in unknown tongues and other excessively spontaneous outbursts were discountenanced, one might well have expected the embryonic brethren to push toward quiet and decorum, not only in their own worship, but also in their study of prophecy. However, the social chemistry at Powers Court had changed markedly in a year. Whereas in the previous year, the Reverend Robert Daly had been in the chair all week and had limited plenary discussion, in 1832 he sometimes let others run discussions. Now, the participants required the right to debate. Thus, a combative, highly assertive tone emerged. The Reverend Peter Rowe, a leading evangelical clergyman but one who did not buy the new apocalyptic prophesying, summarized events as follows. The most extravagant assertions were made, and dogmas quite opposed to each other maintained with the greatest pertinacity. The change in tone, in all likelihood, was generational. The young bucks, among the radical evangelicals, were not willing to accept the church's traditional approach to prophecy, which dealt with prophecy as a distinct entity within the Scriptures. The new mode of reading the Bible, clearly forced to the fore by the discussion menu of the 1832 conference, held that every book of the Bible, both Old and New Testaments, was prophetic. And reading prophetic texts, meaning everything in the Bible, required specific skills and insights. Apparently, these were among the special spiritual gifts given to the young prophets in attendance. The most forceful exponent of the radically prophetic approach to the Scriptures was John Nelson Darby. He had spent the time between the 1831 and 1832 Powers Court house parties in constant travel, meeting with Oxford dons and continental pietistic theologians and, most formatively, the hardscrabble work of supporting small, rural Irish groups of early brethren. He became tougher and more assertive. One infers, but cannot directly prove, that in 1832 Darby was among the strongest proponents of radical apocalyptic prophecy, the loud and often dissonant voices of which drove the Reverend Robert Daly, himself an unabashed proponent of studying prophecy, into a despairing exit. Unlike almost all of the young prophets, Daly was responsible for a congregation of everyday worshippers, and, while he was willing to engage in deep prophetic study with the educated young gentry, he could not accept that the matters the elite argued over, such as how many of the vials of wrath of Revelation had already been poured out upon the earth, were suitable for ordinary pulpit instruction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.